them.
Find something that stimulates you. Find something that terrifies you. Find something that makes you really uncomfortable. Find something that you believe in wholeheartedly and run towards that at 100 miles an hour. I think that's what it is. Because if you're not feeling it, if it doesn't shake you, and, you know, it can stimulate you on many levels. It could be something that makes you not be able to stop laughing, something that makes you not be able to stop crying, something that pisses you off. Whatever it is, it just has to stimulate you on a level that I think is incredibly pronounced and hopefully even profound. And then try and find a way to capture that in what you're making. Because so much of what is put in front of people is either passive or soft or, you know, just flat. And when you can channel something that feels deeply personal on whatever level, I think you have a higher likelihood to create something that will stick with people.
Hey everybody, this is your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 125 of Ars Decoded. In this episode, I get the opportunity to talk to my friend, filmmaker, and director, Julius Onah. This is the return of Mr. Onah from his first appearance on episode number 20, which aired on January 31st of 2016. We get to talk about his newest feature, which released this past weekend, entitled Luce. Luce, played by Kelvin Harrison Jr., is about a 17-year-old prodigy student and all-star high school athlete who is adopted at a very young age as a former child soldier by Amy and Peter Edgar, played by actors Naomi Watts and Tim Roth. His teacher, Miss Wilson, played by Octavia Spencer, finds illegal items in his locker and becomes concerned over the submission of a violently themed research paper. She then contacts his parents, who start to question his actions, leading to his mother, Amy, uncovering a barrage of secrets held by her son. This is an incredible film. It's the kind of film that just sits with you for a while, and you think about it over and over again, and you replay the scenarios in your mind. I've watched the film actually about 3 times now, and each time I uncover a new little nuance and hidden gems within the film. I also have to give a shout out to one of my best friends who is a co-producer on this film. His name is Eric Rowe, and to the amazing people over at Neon who helped set up this interview. So without further ado, here is my conversation with filmmaker Julius Onah talking about his film Luce. Hope you enjoy. Seriously, thanks so much for taking the time to do this.
Oh, it's my pleasure, man. This is a lot of fun, and we had a great conversation. I can't believe, what was that, 2016?
I think so.
2016, so almost 3 years ago.
I think early 2016.
Actually, over 3 years ago. Yeah.
Yeah.
Time flies by. You still look great.
you do too, man.
Trying.
Have you been keeping up with your running?
Yeah, actually, I went on a run this morning. I'm not running as much because I'd hurt my knee actually very soon after we had that. Last time we hung out like this. And I just can't run on it every day anymore. So
what happened? You and I both have
Pan Pacific Park here in LA, and mm-hmm. I fell and my knee just never quite recovered. So I joined a gym, which is something I thought I would never do. And I got a trainer and I've been doing that, but, there we go. Right.
Growing up. Did you get an MRI on it?
You know, I didn't. I didn't have insurance at that time. And I was also super busy because we were prepping another movie. So I couldn't even really step away without, you know, creating issues. But anyway, it is what it is.
Yeah.
I maybe there'll be some form of fantastical new surgery that emerges sometime in the next 5 years that can just heal any ailing part of your body.
Yeah.
So.
Well, if you look into, we don't have to go super into this, but if you look into a PRP, which is essentially they draw your blood and they put in a centrifuge and they extract like blood particles to create stem cells and they re-inject it into like your joint. That's supposed to have some pretty good effects, but I think getting it overseas, like in Germany, I heard they have less regulations from it, like the US does.
Yeah.
So I was thinking about actually doing that eventually, just from sports related injuries and
wow.
stuff.
Maybe I should look into that.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of time in Germany, so.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I know you love Germany.
Yeah, I love Berlin. Yeah. We'll see what happens, but I'm constantly flirting with, do I just, you know, give up on New York and go to Berlin for at least a year?
Yeah.
Which would be nice.
Yeah. Well, I've seen your film now, Luce, about 3 times now.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's insane. Well, it's coming out this weekend, so you could see it 4 times.
Yeah, I think I might, yeah.
with an audience. You know, I've yet to see it with a, like, actual paying audience, you know, because not to say that other audiences didn't pay before, but it's a very specific kind of audience, I think, when you're at a festival or in a screening series or something like that. So just to watch it with, like, a general audience of people who are like, it's Saturday night, it's Friday night, whatever, I'm going out to watch something, to have a 2-hour experience, I would love to see how that audience reacts to the movie.
Yeah. Are you going to?
We'll see if I have time.
Yeah. You know, yeah, it sounds like you're really busy
right now, but you know, maybe at some point in the next couple of weeks, hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll get more than a couple of weeks out there.
Yeah. 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 I really wanted to ask you too, first of all, how did you find out about this play that J.C. Lee created? And then how did you end up teaming up with him to create the adaptation for the screen?
It's a fun origin story. There was a movie that JC was writing for Imagine Entertainment and Brian Grazer and a really smart executive named Kim Roth. And I'd met Kim and Brian a few times, and Kim and Brian brought me back in to talk about a few different scripts. And one of them was the script called The Standards, about a kid who used to cheat on the SATs. And it was being written by JC Lee. And, you know, I had no idea who he was, and I just wanted to know who this writer was and what he was capable of before I really seriously considered the project. And the writing sample they gave me was the play of Luce. And I honestly jumped on that movie because I loved Luce so much. I wanted to learn about the play. I wanted to learn about JC. That kind of started a friendship with him. And I bugged him for several years about adapting it. And he was really busy with his writing career. And, you know, I had another movie that started to go. But finally, a window emerged. And I said to him, look, I'm going to put something together and bring it to you. And JC didn't quite believe me or take it too seriously. So I call him in for breakfast at La Brea Bakery, and I sit down and plop down 130-page script. And he's like, what? And then he realized I was serious, but I think he also thought I was mentally insane. That was kind of the process, and he read it. And fortunately, I was so worried how he'd react. Like, did I just destroy his play? But he responded positively. And, then he went and did a draft of his own and came back to me, and I was excited. And then that started a process of going back and forth. And then the script emerged actually over the course of that process. It was about 3 months, and we had a script that's pretty much the movie you're seeing.
Wow. That's incredible. Yeah. So I'm curious too, like, in terms of your own creative process with your personal work and just stories that are personal to you, like, what is that process usually like? Do you like to create in isolation? Do you like to, like, what is that like?
I do like to create in isolation, and that's one of the things that's been fun about this process with JC, because we're doing it now with a couple of other plays of his. When I go off to do that first draft, he has no idea what I'm going to do with the play. We talk on the macro level about thematically what we want to explore, what kind of ideas we think the story can support.
Yeah.
But in terms of the actual point by point storytelling and even the structure per se, you know, he trusts me enough to let me just go off and do my thing, which is huge. Not a lot of people would trust you to do that with their play.
Yeah.
And then I come back and I give it to him, and, you know, he doesn't say that much. Usually sometimes he doesn't even say anything. And then he just goes off and he does his own thing. And I'm like, okay, great. Now I'm going to go write something else while he's doing this. But that process of isolation is really important, because having that trust from JC, but then also knowing that, like, I can go off and just get lost in my process is super important.
Yeah. Do you usually approach a project from this sort of overlying macro perspective, ideas like, this is kind of what I want this project to be about, even if it's like an adaptation of a play, for instance, like this project, but, or is it different for per each project? Like, what, how do you sort of, like, unravel the intricacies of what a project is supposed to be for you?
It's the former of what you just, presented there. It's kind of getting an overarching idea of what I want it to be. And, you know, sometimes that can start with a sound. You know, music is a big part of the process with for me. And, you know, I might hear a song and I'm just like, oh, that song is the movie. Or it might be an image and, or a moment. And then that is what I start building the movie around. So I just need to have a few things that feel concrete and tangible to me. And then once I have those things, the other part of the process is also asking, well, what's the big idea of this story? You know, what is it? What's the question we want to ask? What's the theme we want to unpack? And then it becomes a process of like, okay, I've got this thing that viscerally grabbed me, whether it's an image, a song, a moment. And then I have these intellectual ideas. How do I merge these things so they feel cohesive and coherent?
Yeah.
And that's, then that will lead into, you know, a certain amount of research or just walking around. Mm. I love to travel, and there's one of the things I find most inspiring is just going to a city I don't really know well and walking around and kind of getting lost in it because you don't even have preconceived notions of where you can go.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you just walk around and it's like, okay, yeah, well, I guess I'll go down this street for a little while. And that's, yeah, kind of like the creative process, right? You're like, all right, I guess I'll walk down that road, yeah, for a little while and we'll see what happens.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. You know, I find it really interesting about the creative process too. And I mean, if we're talking about like traveling to another country and you don't know the language, so then you're just pointing to things on the menu and, you know, and then like that, I feel like that is part of just this sort of like love and discovery for life. You know, it's being able to step outside your comfort zone and also challenge yourself to step outside your comfort zone. But then also there's a lot of things about the creative process too, that I'm thinking about sort of like spontaneity and sort of concrete things that keep you in check, you know? Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there like sort of certain routines that you like to do that kind of like keep that creative process flowing and in check, as well as like certain things that you like to challenge yourself with, like stepping out of your comfort zone, that help?
There's certainly routines, you know, and some of them are structural things and some of them are kind of just rituals that I engage in. And, you know, speaking of running, like we were talking about, I love to run, and I usually get a lot of my best ideas. Like, I think the two places I get my best ideas are running and in the shower. Mm. But there's just moments when your unconscious mind starts to go.
Yeah.
And then things come to you. Mm. So usually when I run and get into a good rhythm and I'm listening to music, things start to happen, and then you extrapolate from there. And,
yeah.
And sometimes, weirdly enough, I think it's just the white noise of the shower. Mm. You know, it just kind of lulls you. And then the other thing's walking around too. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So those are all things that when a project is in its gestational stage, but even at any stage, when we're editing, when we're at any part of the creative process, I'm trying to find those opportunities for unconscious inspiration, I think are so important, because I think that offers you the opportunity to surprise yourself.
Yeah.
And then in terms of going out of one's comfort zone, you know, that often is just something when you're trying to pick the subject matter, right? Or when you are thinking through the story and the journey the characters need to go through. You know, if the characters go to an uncomfortable place, then you're going to go to an uncomfortable place. Mm. And it's just about being willing to let these people go to places that scare you and that might scare an audience too.
Mm. Yeah. Do you, cause recently I started journaling actually, and especially doing it right in the morning, right when I wake up, to start writing down thoughts. And it's kind of like that thing about tapping into the subconscious, because your conscious mind isn't, as aware of what you're doing. So you can't logically, at least for me, I am not logically trying to think about what I need to do of the day, you know? So do you journal at all?
No, I've tried every now and then, but I don't have the discipline for it. You know, I love reading. You know, reading often helps create an unconscious avenue. And, you know, I've actually been watching a fair number of documentaries recently.
Which ones?
Well, there's a bunch on Netflix that are kind of around new media. And,
The Great Hack. The Great Hack. Oh, yeah. It's
great. Yeah. But there was even one that they had about social media influencers. I think it was called American something. I can't remember the full name.
Okay.
But they covered like Paris Hilton. What's his name? The fat Jewish.
The fat Jewish.
And then there was this party photographer named the Slut Whisperer. There was this woman who was a comedian who was a big Vine star.
Oh, interesting.
And I found that interesting. Then, of course, for a moment, there was a lot of talk about those two Fyre Festival documentaries, which I watched both the Hulu one that interviewed the entrepreneur who tried to create Fyre, really the con man, and then also the Netflix one that profiled him and Ja Rule.
Yeah.
So those were just a series of things that I kept on watching. There's another doc I'm dying to see that was at Sundance this year called Jawline by this talented director named Liza Manlup, I think is her full name. But that too is about social media, celebrity, but a teenage kid who kind of develops this big following of young women. So that's been interesting. And then I've also been just reading a bunch of Marshall McLuhan, both his work, but then also writing about him. So things like that, that just like kind of let your mind wander and, you know, and his stuff is so heady and cerebral. And but nonetheless, that kind of stuff I find inspiring.
I mean, going back to the whole macro perspective thing, do you try to dissect certain things that you're thinking about, like within that, I don't know, year, within those, in that moment or whatever, into something that you can potentially put into a script?
When you say dissect, what exactly?
Just kind of like, you know, I think of like things in general as patterns, you know, there's certain patterns to the way that you do things, or certain patterns the way that I do things, and trying to understand why we do those specific patterns. Like for you, it's, you know, you like to run, and that's kind of where you can have like a clearer headspace and tap into your subconscious, you know. But I'm just trying to think of ways to dissect things to put it into artwork. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It does make sense. I'm trying to wrap my head around, just because, you know, I often don't think that consciously about what the process is. But
yeah,
I think for me, it's the pattern is just information gathering, you know. And as I said, the means of that information gathering sometimes is going on a run and letting unconscious information find you. Sometimes it's reading and doing research. Sometimes it's just going on a walk. Sometimes it's a conversation, something you'll hear.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons I love being in New York, and, you know, I also am excited about being in a place like Berlin, is you might just hear somebody say something and it sends you off in this other direction. And, you know, it's nice to be in an environment that's really populated. Whereas there's other places like Los Angeles, where I think you're spending so much time in your car, you don't have those kind of spontaneous moments of interaction with people in the same way.
So, that's interesting.
Yeah. Well, I just, when I was spending time here, I was like, I felt like I couldn't tap into all that. Like that opportunity to just kind of spiral in a different direction and be spontaneous and
being in Los Angeles.
Yeah. Whereas New York and Berlin and London and places like that. I was just in Stockholm recently, and that was really fun. And I got a weird idea for something I wanted to try doing at some point. Having just that activity around me is really fun. But going back to your question of dissecting things, the dissection comes after the information gathering. So I just need to be stimulated enough to collect all the information I need before I can get analytical about the process.
That's interesting, because the way that you just describe things sounds very much like part of the process to you creating your film, The Girl Is in Trouble.
Yeah.
It seems like it's a reaction from your experiences from living in New York, and then also just like the subtle decision making that happens within between those characters, you know?
Yeah, I mean, and that's what was fun about what we were trying to do with that project. And, you know, I learned a tremendous amount from it. I'd actually love to go back and try to do something like that again. Probably more efficiently and coherently and with a little bit more control. You know, with the kind of processes we're talking about, I think control and trust are so important. And by control, I mean control of what you are doing, having the facility to actually execute on your intentions versus, you know, you're trying at things and maybe you hit the target, maybe you don't. And then trust is having the trust of your collaborators, having the trust of your financier, having the trust of the people around you who are facilitating the process. Because that is incredibly important to being able to execute.
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, if you're fighting an uphill battle and you don't have trust of, you know, your peers or like certain people around you, then that could be definitely very difficult.
Absolutely. Well, it stifles the creativity.
Exactly.
At a certain
point,
you're just, you know, phoning it in.
Yeah. So prior to doing, Luce, you had, I think it was 11 short films that came out and 2 features. So can you talk about the experience that accumulated from doing all of those projects and being able to take those experiences and put them into the film that you're doing with Luce?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's just more so than anything, clarity of vision and clarity of intentionality.
Yeah.
With all those little short films, they were an opportunity to experiment with a different style, with a different, approach, but they were all lessons in having a clarity of vision and intentionality. And also the 2 feature projects, you know, now the first feature was a film that, you know, had challenges around it, but at its core was something that was birthed by me and a friend. The second project, you know, started off as something that I think could have been really interesting, but unfortunately sort of fell into the trap of, a set of expectations that it probably never should have. So in many ways that was a real lesson, I think, in what can go wrong when people who have power in that process don't have a clear, authentic intentionality to what they're doing. And Luce was an opportunity to set some real boundaries around how the movie was going to be made, both in terms of, you know, people financially involved in the film, other crew people involved with the film, because I felt those boundaries were essential to being able to preserve that clarity of vision and intentionality. So the real lesson over the course of those 11 short films and 2 features was the essential need to protect what the thing needs to be at all costs, and to make sure that your key collaborators are on the same page about that.
Yeah.
Because if they're not, then everybody's making a different project, and what you're going to end up with is something nobody's going to be happy with.
Yeah, it seems like when you're taking on a role that is so important as the director of a film, it's not only the project that you have to adhere to, but it's also about understanding who you need to bring on the team, whether it's casting certain people for specific parts. And it's also about like which people you can get for those parts. But it's also seems like it's a lot about just the people management too.
Yeah. I mean, I've heard directors say very often, half the time your job is, just managing this huge personnel of people. And, you know, it's maybe 90% delegation and decision-making and 10% actual creativity. And that's what I think was so unique about filmmaking, particularly as a creative endeavor, because it's the only one that encompasses pretty much every form of media and art. You have actors and text. So you're dealing with, you know, at one point writing and then at another point performance. And then you've got costumes, you've got production and set design, you've got music, you've got the camera, you've got lighting. And then eventually, you know, the one that is entirely unique to this form, which is the editing process. But now you bring in computer technology and visual effects. The amount of delegation across different fields and decision-making across different fields that are required to create something that feels unified is mind-boggling when you think about it.
Oh yeah.
But I always keep on coming back to, you are trying to recreate life or imagine a life that doesn't quite exist. Right. So if it's a fantasy, then you need to create a whole set of rules for a world. And then if you're recreating either contemporary or period reality, you're trying to recreate the chaos of all that. But even in the imagined form of it, there has to be a chaos to it too, right? And that's what I think is so tricky when you watch a lot of these big science fiction, stories or big tentpole movies. 9 times out of 10, they're missing that imagined chaos and messiness that makes a world feel really real. And it's like, when I think about recent films that pulled it off, I always keep on coming back to the first Matrix, because somehow they realized a world in that film that just feels so lived in and imaginative, but also chaotic and messy. It's really kind of fantastic. And it's rare.
Yeah. And I really like what you, at least this last screening that I went to, and I was listening to Q&A with you and JC, and you were talking about, and this actually really impacted me on a visceral level, is you guys were talking about going deeper into the script and being able to, and what it meant to me, I think, is just having a deeper understanding of the human psychology and the interactions between the characters, and not just, because I think a lot of films fail, whatever genre it is or whatever the set of circumstances is, it doesn't have that sort of thing that grounds you to a reality, but it's also like that fantastical thing that you're talking about
I called it a chaos, right? It chaos, has to have a controlled chaos to it, where it feels like there's a sense of intentionality to the filmmaking and purposefulness, but at the same time, it has the messiness that is reflective of life. I mean, like, you just look around and you see somebody going over there with a hand truck and cars and somebody on a moped, and, eventually somebody's going to fall and trip and a baby's going to cry and, just like shit's going to happen. And you kind of need that messiness and sloppiness within a film, yet, or a story, but you also need control. And you can take that, you can parallel that to, a family making dinner or breakfast in the morning and everything that's happening. And that's the thing that for me is really hard to achieve and takes real work, and some of it's
starts. What is controlling the chaos?
Yeah, creating and pitching the right control chaos. And that's something that is a real learning process. And I think for every director, I've seen, there's a great thing Akira Kurosawa said. I'm going to butcher it a little bit, but it was like, essentially that there's no such thing as being a master of film. You're always a student of film. You might achieve mastery, but you never become a master, because at any point in time, you can essentially make something terrible. If the right intentionality is not there, if the right control is not there, if the right elements aren't in place. And that's, a really powerful and humble statement for somebody like Akira Kurosawa to say, essentially, that I'm always going to be a student of this. Because as you try with every single story or film, it's almost like you could take the years of experience you have, but it is like you're starting off anew, because you have to build it from the ground up.
Yeah. And also it's a good lesson just in life in general, outside of filmmaking, to be able to, whatever sort of milestone you hit in life, whether it's, personal milestone or what have you, to be able to balance out your ego in a way, to be able to come back down and understand. Because I feel like there's a lot of filmmakers that have kind of lost touch with reality, and then so their films start to become kind of convoluted and, I'm making a generalization, but
it's not a misplaced generalization. It's something me and my collaborators talk about all the time, as you start to achieve, if you do achieve that, a certain degree of comfort and a certain degree of privilege, and a certain degree of power in the way you were able to tell your stories. It's something that, and I share this often with people, Tennessee Williams talked about. He wrote this article in, I think it was in the New Yorker, called The Catastrophe of Success. And it was essentially about the ways in which, when you achieve a tremendous success in your field, and obviously he was a playwright, the success and the comfort that comes from that, the complacency to a certain degree that comes from that as well, encourages you to take less risks. You lose touch with that thing that made you strive in the very beginning. Just the difficulty of day-to-day human life and rhythms of, am I going to be able to pay my rent? What am I going to eat? How am I going to balance my professional ambitions with my personal life? When all those things start to get almost melt away into a certain kind of privilege and comfort, it can be really hard to create. You know, and that to me is what you're describing as losing a touch with reality. And yeah. I see that a lot in a number of filmmakers who I have admired who, you know, at a certain point, their set of concerns just become so removed from the way life is lived. And all I can imagine is just because, you know, at a certain point when you are no longer dealing with the types of challenges that most people do have to live with in their life, how can you relate and tell stories about that?
Yeah.
So it's a very difficult balance, I think, to negotiate. You almost need to maintain a degree of being mundane in your life to be able to, I think, tell those kinds of stories.
Yeah.
Now, not everybody wants to do that. Some people want to exist purely in the realm of fantasy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, but even then, you know, when you're making some of these films, and I don't want to knock anybody in specific, but you can see the difference between, you know, some of the early work in fantasy and then some of the stuff that just becomes,
yeah,
you know, plastic.
Yeah. And then, I mean, and then I guess that comes back down to understanding the intentionality of the film as well and the intention of the filmmaker.
Yeah.
But what do you think keeps on drawing you back to filmmaking?
Well, I haven't figured it out.
but you keep coming back to it.
That's what I'm saying. You know, I haven't figured it out. I feel like with every single film,
I see what you mean.
I leave saying, fuck, well, I need to do that thing better. I need to do that thing better. You know, I don't think I'll probably ever figure it out. So that's the reason to keep on coming back to, you know, try to make a better film than the last one and make a more complete film than the last one. So that's one thing. And then the other thing is there's just a lot of stuff on my mind that I want to explore, a lot of ideas, and also feeling that the perspective I'm coming from in telling these stories is probably not what a majority of what people are seeing is, you know, because I have a unique set of experiences that brought me to where I am, being born in Nigeria, growing up in the Philippines and in England and Togo and Equatorial Guinea and all these places, moving to Arlington and then spending a huge chunk of time in Berlin and Copenhagen and other places. So there's a real perspective I have in terms of the types of stories I want to tell and the ways I want to tell them and what I want them to be about. So when I combine all that, wanting to tell stories that I don't quite feel are being told, A, and wanting just to get better at what I do, B, it's a reason to wake up every morning and get back to work.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think the more that we all can be more in touch with the idea that the experiences that we go through, even if you have, well, actually you do have a twin. Yeah. I was going to say, even if you have a twin, the experiences that you go through are unique to your own perspective, the way you process things, even if you're in the same exact circumstances, people tend to process things differently. So I think the thing that a lot of us have to keep in mind is that we are unique.
Yeah.
We do have a specific perspective. And if you're an artist, it's what mediums do you use to fulfill those ideas and those internal processes, right?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. So what's next for you, man?
So, you know, I don't want to say too much about it just because I think it's a thing that's going to need to live on its own. But there's a series of plays that JC wrote, Luce being one of them. And there's two other of them that we kind of just stumbled on this a few weeks ago that like there could be a really exciting set of movies to make, kind of a trilogy of movies that explore identity in America from a different perspective than I think most people would come at with it, using the engine of genre as a mechanism to propel these stories, but not short shrifting the ideas that we want to explore. And, you know, Luce in many ways was the first step in that direction. And these two other stories that I would like to do with him, I think, create a complete cycle. That's one of the things on the front of my mind right now.
Yeah.
So, you know, we've already written one of them and next step is to work on the other one.
Mm. So are they this in the same universe as Luce or like an adjacent universe?
Well, they're all, you know, hopefully in the world that we live in, And I think stylistically and thematically, they're going to be extensions of what Luce is doing. So I hesitate to use the word universe just because that's become like a thing now with Marvel and all that other stuff. I'll just say they're part of a cycle of stories.
Mm. So whether you believe in this or not, but can you talk a bit about this sort of idea of kindred spirits?
Yeah.
And finding your kindred spirits, whether, you know, people sometimes call it a tribe or what have you, but do you feel that you have some sort of soul connection to JC and that's why you kind of can collaborate in this capacity?
It's really bizarre, but I do think there's a meeting of minds there. And I remember when I first read Luce, I was like, wow, it feels like somebody's looking in my head and it's really weird. But I didn't connect the dots into it being something more. You know, we'd worked on this other script together and the script turned out really well. It wasn't something I wrote on, but I developed it with him. And then we did Luce, and then we've already done another thing with each other, a third script. And it was, you know, people around us who kept on saying like, oh, you know, there might be something there. And that was when the light bulb first went off. I was like, oh, maybe they're right. And in some ways that makes it even better because I don't think it was conscientious. It was never like, oh my God, we're going to, you know, go do this thing. It just, you know, and I think there's that kind of a healthy space between us in terms of how we like to create. But then, in, you know, personal life wise, you know, he's doing his thing here in LA and I'm in New York and, you know, we talk often, but, I think we have, kind of like a nice set of boundaries in terms of how we collaborate, but then also at the same time, you know, having our own independent spheres of creativity.
Hmm. Yeah. So I brought up those shorts that you did early on and how that kind of, you know, being able to experiment on each project and, being able to accumulate all these ideas to come together into an eventual, another project such as Luce. What do you think, like, what is, some advice that you can give to people that are first time filmmakers or maybe just starting off and doing their first short? Like, what do you think? What's some advice that you can give them?
Find something that stimulates you, find something that terrifies you, find something that makes you really uncomfortable, find something that you believe in wholeheartedly and run towards that at 100 miles an hour. I think that's what it is. Because if you're not feeling it, if it doesn't shake you and, you know, it can stimulate you on many levels. It could be something that makes you not be able to stop laughing, something that makes you not be able to stop crying, something that pisses you off. Whatever it is, it just has to stimulate you on a level that I think is incredibly pronounced and hopefully even profound. And then try and find a way to capture that in what you're making. Because so much of what is put in front of people is either passive or soft or, you know, just flat. And when you can channel something that feels deeply personal on whatever level, I think you have a higher likelihood to create something that will stick with people.
Yeah. Cause that's kind of what I was thinking about in terms of just filmmaking in general and kind of why it's important for some people. I mean, I think there's just some creators and some artists that kind of straight out of the box in their youth have something interesting to say that could interesting, meaning like resonating with many people and can make some sort of like cultural impact in some way. But, I think, sometimes there needs to be this sort of gestation process to be able to understand the reasons why you want to say something and what you're saying and why you're saying it. And I think that takes time for a lot of people. So I think like doing shorts is a way to be able to kind of start piecing the puzzle together, which is, you know, at the end of the puzzle, it's your eventual life, wherever that puzzle may lead you. Right. But,
absolutely.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I'm asking for myself, but also for people that are listening out there.
Oh yeah. I mean, look, it's so many things. It's experimenting. There's risks you can take with shorts, as you've alluded to. What you were just saying about in terms of finding your tribe, your collaborators, that's another way to find people. One of my producers on Luce, John, we made shorts together when I was in film school at NYU. He wasn't at NYU, but he produced one of my shorts. Eric Rowe, another producing partner, we did a music video together. I think that was our first real creative collaboration together. You know, so these little experiments help you find the people you can trust and collaborate with. And then also start to test out these ideas that you have and feelings that you have. So I think it's really important to do that. I still want to make shorts. It's not like for me, I'm not going to make shorts anymore. You know, a big project I'm building is this idea of trying to make a short on every continent on the planet. So, you know, I'm even considering potentially making a short this fall. As we've been talking, in the back of my mind, I'm like, fuck, I should really try and get that short made if I can figure out the money to do it.
Yeah.
So I think there's something very valuable about the short form, and equally important. And, you know, when you can do it too and make a really interesting music video or an interesting commercial, those are really exciting things.
Yeah. Because now I'm thinking about a lot of different things, but... we went over the inspiration thing.
You edit all this together?
Oh, well, yeah, I cut certain parts out of it.
So all this stuff is not...
No. The lulls. No, actually, I emphasize the lulls, and I put that in another episode.
You do?
No.
Because it would actually be really interesting to make like a radio show hour that like you cut out all the substantive bits and you made it just, it's actually something Jim Jarmusch talks about a lot. My movies are what happened in between other people's movies. So like when he was making Stranger Than Paradise, it's all the scenes and all the moments in between what you think the movie should be.
That's amazing. I love that.
And you know, that's always kind of been a part of his deadpan style, but yeah. Stranger Than Paradise is such a fantastic
movie. I haven't seen it.
I'll see that movie.
Okay.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible. So fucking good.
Well, I mean, that's even, you know, going back and talking about this sort of the mundane experiences of life and then trying to find some beauty and essence out of that and understanding that there's nuance in everything. That's what I really like about Luce too, is it's that story could essentially happen in any sort of situation or stories like that, and those feelings colliding together and in a way, but you guys really channeled like the nuance of the human psychology, I feel like.
Yeah. I mean, look, we had phenomenal actors. There were a lot of conversations between JC and I. JC started this off with a beautiful play. And we really tried to honor and be honest in the process of making the story. And, you know, it's funny as you were talking about that, like when I think about some of my favorite moments in the movie, it's just Tim and Naomi in their car and they're driving to this sip and see, kind of like a baby shower. And they're both in the front seat, and in the back seat, they have a car seat, a baby car seat with a little bow on it. And Naomi and Tim's character have just had a fight. And she looks over at him and he doesn't do anything. He just keeps driving. And then she looks back and he's like, great. Like that to me is such a wonderful encapsulation of what feels like a real moment in a relationship when they both have something on their mind that they don't want to talk about. And her looking at him kind of as a nonverbal communication, and him not looking back as a nonverbal communication, says so much more than if they had talked about it.
Oh, yeah.
And those are some of my little favorite moments in the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, there's another moment where Calvin, Luce is in a shed and he's talking to his friend, and his friend has just said something racially charged, and Calvin tries to blow it off and paper over it to make everything okay. And he, you know, he smacks his knee against his friend, and then they laugh, and then she's like, oh, nothing just happened. And, you know, those are all the things that you can't quite script, but they're moments an actor can create, and it's beautiful.
Yeah. I think it's also your job as a director to understand when those moments are powerful and what they do to help push the story forward as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And understanding, I mean, I love the dialogue in the film, but I mean, you know, like you're saying, also those scenes when it's just moments that are, yeah, nonverbal and subtextual, they really add into the essence of the film. Yeah. Cause it tells a lot about the story of Naomi Watts and Tim Roth's characters and kind of what made them adopt a child in the first place. And I mean, but it encapsulates all of those things, like you're saying, the complications of a relationship and the human experience.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, thanks, dude. Thanks for
doing
this.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. Always, always a fan and always want to be back. So
yeah, you're awesome, man.
Thanks, buddy.